Well, thank you very much for giving me the impossible task to talk about issues such as lymphoma and chemo-free treatment. And number two, I'd like to declare this jacket-free talk. And with that, so DLBCL, what do we know about chemo-free regimens? And I would like to discuss some of the pros and cons there. I have some disclosures to make. And I would like to start with some considerations. So it's not easy to put this into context, but of course, when we talk about chemo-free agents, we have to think about chemo combinations. We have to talk about antibody-conjugated drugs. And then I will show some data on true chemo-free in induction, maintenance, mono combination therapy, and then, of course, cellular therapy could be regarded as chemo-free, but I will not allude very much on that. And then it's in this field, I think it's all about prediction of response, because we will be talking about a few subgroups who may profit from chemo-free treatment. And I think we should spend some effort on talking about this. This is the concept. I think currently we are all clear that chemotherapy remains the backbone of first-line treatment. And all major clinical evidence suggests that aggressive chemotherapy is mandatory for these patients. However, we've seen trials that showed that we are at the upper edge of chemotherapy, so I think we have to another patient here, an elderly patient, not fit enough for chemotherapy anymore, had received various types of treatment before that, including VDB, and there was no decent response in the end. But what we noticed is that this patient had a high MUM1 expression, so we thought, well, let's try lenalidomide, and the patient responded, having not responded to all the other chemotherapy treatments. So there is a potential, but we have, of course, to find the biomarkers, and we have to find out what's going on. Apart from the naked antibodies and polatuzumab, I'd like to point out the quite interesting effect of the bispecifics. For instance, rituximab. And if you look at the activity of rituximab in diffuse large B-cell lymphoma, then you see that one cycle of treatment can produce, even in diffuse large B-cell lymphomas, refractory or relapsed, nice overall response rate. So there is a potential for these bispecifics. And there is a whole class of these coming out also at this meeting. And I'd like to point out that you can have various combinations with the CD19, CD3, CD20, CD3 in various combinations. And we will all be looking forward to the studies that come out now, either in monotherapy or in combination. Also in early phases. So I think there is still potential. By the way, the response rates we see in the beginning for the PFS are almost as high as for the cutisets. But I would like to point out that there are some differences, and I will allude to that afterwards. So this is essentially the table that puts together most of the evidence. It's definitely not complete of true chemo-free therapy in DLBCL relapse refractory. And again, if you look in this column, you see 37% response rate with ibrutinib mono in the ABC type, but only 5% in the GCP. So we need to consider subgroups. And that also goes, for instance, for the ACH2 inhibitor. 40% in diffuse large B-cell lymphoma with the corresponding mutation, only 80% when you don't have the mutation. You can also put it the other way around. Why do we have 80% mutations if you don't have the mutation? So there are things that we don't completely understand at this point. And there are other agents like, of course, blinatumumab, pembrolizumab, related to biomarkers that we have. And certainly think that these are the response rates that we will be looking at in the future, around 30 to 40%. Monotherapy for maintenance, we could not show a difference. What we showed in this NHS trial is that there may be differences between men and women, but again, the overall study was negative. The open study was presented at EHA this year and showed the same result. So the only trial that was positive for maintenance was the REMARK study. And once again, there was a funny composition of the subgroups, actually, which was a bit unexpected, but the whole trial was positive. What can we expect for cutisets? That's maybe the landmark that I would like to set. Is what we see with the CARs is that there is a plateau. And most of the non-chemo agents that we've been seeing have good PFS, but we don't see the plateau. And that's probably what we have to aim for. And there may be some differences. Finally, predicting response, of course, will be our task for the future. We have some biomarkers like GCB versus ABC type, and they are related to some of the mutations, so the mutations are not equally distributed between those two. And there are numerous examples now of whole genome or whole exome sequencing or expression data that point to the fact that we can identify, in this case for instance, 5 subgroups of diffuse large B-cell lymphomas which may respond different to various agents. So we should do companion diagnostics right when you do these studies. We have been tackling this not by genetics, but by automated drug testing, and we have had some interesting results also in diffuse large B-cell lymphomas and other aggressive B-cell lymphomas. Also something to watch for the future. Can we functionally predict what's happening when you give a drug to patients who may have, for instance, two or three mutations at the same time? And this is my final slide. So I think it's all about selection and precision. Our task right now is to find the needle in the haystack, which means that 15 to 20 to 30% of patients who will respond. We certainly have to study combinations and ADCs at this point, and then there may be novel developments of small molecules and antibodies and cellular immunotherapies, which hold some promise, but we'll probably have to look at that. And that's my message. So